Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our Kill Street Christian Church Adult Sunday School here in Toronto, in Ontario, Canada. Welcome, brothers and sisters. Today is Lord's Day here, and welcome to our lesson number two. This morning, we will talk and share to each other, to each one. The topic that we're going to discuss is about a sorrow without fear. An invitation to encounter God. So this is going to be taken from the book of Psalms 42 and 43. So this is going to be our second Sunday series of our 8 Sundays series on healing the world. So welcome everyone, and join with us for an hour study of the Word of God. From the book of Psalms chapter 42 and 43. Before we start, let's bow our heart and let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we are here to give you thanks, to lift up your name in heaven, because you are our God of our salvation. Thank you, Lord, for another day that you have given to each one of us. And thank you for brothers and sisters who are here studying with us. Bless each one of us, Lord, as your children who are watching and listening to this live stream. May your grace and your love be with them, Lord, and give them peace in their hearts so that they will experience the joy of salvation that comes from you. Bless our hearts, Lord, as we study your words at this time. And you may also guide, Lord, your instrument that you're going to use to share your words from the scriptures. This is all we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So, brothers and sisters, turn on your Bible on the book of Psalms, chapter 42 and 43. And we're going to share to each one of us about the story of the life of these writers who wrote these Psalms, chapter 42 and 43. So, the background of this chapters from the book of Psalms is unfortunately the leader of the rebellion during the time of Moses, when they're in the desert, when they survived the crossing of the Red Sea, because last Sunday we are talking about the crossing of the Red Sea. Now the continuation of that lesson last Sunday is now they are already in the wilderness. While they are in the wilderness, there is a Levite named Korah, and his descendants is the one who wrote the book of Psalms, chapter 42 and 43. But I would like you to understand and to know about the story of these people before they wrote this Psalms, chapter 42 and 43. There is a story behind these letters or these Psalms, because their descendants is the leader of the rebellion during the time of Moses. If you will open your Bible in the Old Testament in the book of Numbers, chapter 16, verses 1 to 35, you will see the story of their ancestors, the one who wrote the Psalms chapter 42 and 43. These were the sons of Korah. You know, Korah incites rebellion in the time of Moses. If you will see it in chapter 16 of Deuteronomy, I'm sorry, Numbers, you will see that Korah is from the tribe of Levites. And we know that Levites is the people who are serving and ministering in the tabernacle, which is commanded by God through Moses and Aaron, that this clan of one of the tribe of Israel will serve the Lord, but they will not inherit a promised land or a lot, or you know, when they reach the promised land. They will concentrate on serving the Lord. They will consecrate themselves. And but beside this, there is a sad story of Korah that I will share with you, that Korah is son of Ishar, and son of Kohath, and son of Levi. So there are three men who rebelled against Moses. And they thought that doing this is giving them a chance to enlighten Moses' understanding, that they think that God is with them, these three gentlemen, you know, three men who were rebelled against Moses. And they think about something that it's good for them to lead the nation of Israel instead of Moses. So I will give you the background of how these three men rebelled against Moses. And then it doesn't mean that if you have your descendants following with you or after you, it will be the same as their ancestors. But in this story, it's different, because the writer of the Psalms, chapter 42 and 43, they were the children or the ancestor, the descendants of Korah, one among those three who rebelled against Moses in his time. So here, beside the Korah, Dathan and Abiram, those three leading men who rebelled against Moses, they took 250 prominent Israelite men who were leaders of the community in Israel and representatives in the assembly, and they rebelled against Moses. So this is the sad story of this time. So they came together against Moses and Aaron and told them, "You have gone too far." So I would like to give you the background before we go to Psalms 42 and 43. So they said to Moses these words, "You have gone too far, Moses." And he said, they said, "Everyone in the anteroom community is holy, and the Lord is among them. So why then do you exalt yourselves above the Lord's assembly?" So they were accusing Moses and Aaron for leading the nation of Israel. So in verse 4 of chapter 16 of the book of Numbers, when Moses heard these words, he fell face down. Then he said to Korah and all his followers, "Tomorrow morning the Lord will reveal who belongs to him, who is set apart, and the one he will let come near him, he will let the one he chooses come near him. So Korah, you and all your followers are to do this. Take fire pans, and tomorrow place fire in them and put incense on them before the Lord. Then the man the Lord chooses will be the one who is set apart. It is you Levites who have gone too far." And then Moses also told Korah, "Now listen, Levites. Isn't it enough for you that the God of Israel has separated you from the Israelite community to bring you near to himself to perform the work of the Lord's tabernacle and to stand before the community to minister to them? He has brought you near and all your fellow Levites who are with you, but you are seeking the priesthood as well. Therefore, it is you and all your followers who have conspired against the Lord. As for Aaron, who is he that you should complain about him?" So this is what happened to the accusation to Moses and Aaron. And then this is what Moses told them: "Tomorrow we will meet the Lord together." And then on that night, the Lord speak to Moses. And this is what the Lord replied to Moses: "Tell the community, get away from the dwellings of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram." And Moses got up and went to Dathan and Abiram, and the elders of Israel followed him. This is from verse 25 of chapter 16 of the book of Numbers. So he wanted the community, "Get away now from the tents of these wicked men. Don't touch anything that belongs to them, or you will be swept away because of all their sins." So they got away from the dwellings of Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. Meanwhile, Dathan and Abiram came out and stood at the entrance of their tents with their wives, children, and infants. Verse 28. So then Moses said, "This is how you will know that the Lord sent me to do all these things, and that it was not of my own will. If these men die naturally as all people would, and suffer the fate of all, then the Lord has not sent me. But if the Lord brings about something unprecedented, and the ground opens its mouth and swallows them along with all that belongs to them, so that they go down alive into Sheol, then you will know that these men have despised the Lord. Then verse 31, just as he finished speaking all these words, the ground beneath them split open. The earth opened its mouth and swallowed them and their household, all Korah's people and all their possessions. They went down alive into Sheol with all that belonged to them. The earth closes over them and they vanish from the assembly. At their cries, all the people of Israel who were around them fled because they thought the earth may swallow us too. Fire also came out from the Lord and consumed the 250 men who were presenting the incense. So this is the this is the effect of the rebellion, you know, from these three men, and then the 250 men who followed them. This is a sad story when people was rescued by the Lord through Moses and Aaron. The people didn't appreciate, you know, the kindness of the Lord through them, you know, from the and this action by God was promised by their descendants, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And for the Israelites, they should be thankful for these promises that God gave them. So in Psalms chapter 42 through 49, these Psalms were written by the descendants of Korah. So we know the story about Korah and the other men who rebelled against Moses. Korah was a Levite who led Dathan and Abihu, or Abiram. It's a, you know, a rebellion against Moses in Numbers chapter 16, verses 1 to 35. He was killed, you know, through the opening of the earth, you know, through earthquake. But his descendants remained faithful to God and continued to serve God in the temple. So David appointed men from the clan of Korah to serve as choir leaders, mentioned in 1 Chronicles chapter 6, verses 31 to 38. And they continued to be temple musicians for hundreds of years. You will see that on 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verses 18 to 19. You may have parents or ancestors who rejected God or rebelled against Him. That doesn't need to be a curse on your life, you know, because Ezekiel chapter 18, verses 19 to 24 said that the sins of the parents will not inherited by the children or by the son, because each person guilty of their own sin, it will not be affected to their children, you know. So individual person, you are responsible for your own action. So if a father sin against God, the son is not, because the son is not sinning against God. So whoever person who sin against God is the one who is guilty of sinning against the Lord. And then the person will see the punishment of God being a disobedient person. So here, you will see that in Ezekiel chapter 18, verses 19 to 24. That is the truth about individual responsibility. So we have liberty to break that cycle of history and start a new line of people loyal to God. This is what we call thirsting for God in trouble and exile. Sometimes these things happen during the time of distress, loneliness, hardship in life, and people start complaining, grumbling, and doing these things because they cannot take the hardship of life anymore. That's why they become rebellious people, because they don't rely on God, you know, of His provisions in every day of their lives. They just only think about the present time, the present moment of their life. They don't believe really fully in God. They don't give their lives to God. That's why they become earthly people, you know, people who rely on the things on this world. So this Psalms is for the music director, a maskil of the sons of Korah. Now, there is a musicians also in the temple who serve in the temple. So the musicians, the people who play the music, the musical instrument, were the sons of Korah, the descendants of Korah. It was appointed by King David in his time, and it's continuing up to the time of King Solomon. So in verse 1 of chapter 42, you'll see this is a song of worship. This is also we sing during the worship time in our congregation during Lord's Day, you know. As the deer longs for stream of water, so I long for you, God. So this is the other version of the Christian Standard Bible that I use. But in another version, it says that as the deer pants for the water brooks, so my soul pants for you, God. Verse 2, my soul thirsts for God, for the living God. When shall I come and appear before God? So this is a question of the psalmist. As the life of a deer depends on water, every human being, either animal, plants, you know, and all of us, creations of God, needs water to live and to survive. So our lives depend on God. Those who seek Him and long to understand Him find never-ending life. Feeling separated from God, and this psalm writer wouldn't rest until his relationship with God was restored, because he knew that his very life depended on it. So do you thirst for God? So this is a good question. As human beings, as we thirst for our thirstiness, you know, in this flesh, in this body, we also thirst for God spiritually. Do our prayers reflect an urgent and intense desire to be with Him? A lot of people in this world wants to be with God, you know. They want to end this life because of so many hardship and discomfort in this world, because we are in a human being's status. So that's why the psalmist said in verse 3, my tears have been my food day and night, while they say to me all day long, where is your God? So this is going to be a question for all the people who are always asking God, where is your God? I remember these things and poured out my soul within me. Verse 4, for I used to go over with the multitude and walk them to the house of God. With a voice of joy and thanksgiving, a multitude celebrating a festival. So in verse 5, why are you in despair, my soul? It's a good question. And why are you restless within me? So the psalmist is talking to himself. He's talking to his soul. Huh? Wait for God. You know, the spirit said to the soul, for I will again praise him for the help of his presence, my God. So the writer of this psalm was discouraged because he was exiled to a place far from Jerusalem and could not worship in the temple. So the background of these psalms, they were in the exile. You know, after the Babylonian captivity, all of the Jewish royals, the Jewish people, was transferred to Persia, you know, to Susa in Persia, which is the modern Iran. Excuse me. So they were exiled because of their disobedience to God. All of them in that time, they didn't follow God. They become prostituted to the idols that God prohibited to them to worship, because God said, like, you know, you should only worship me, nobody else, you know. But the people of Israel didn't follow and disrespect God for prostitute them to the idols. That's why God declared judgment on them. So during the God-given holidays, the Israelites were to remember all that God had done for them through festivals. You know, there are so many Jewish festivals until today. They are celebrating, like, Passover, you know, the Feast of the Booths, the Feast of Pentecost, you know, and there are so many more. So many of these festivals are explained in the Old Testament. So in verse 6, my soul is in despair within me. Therefore, I remember you from the land of the Jordan and the peaks of Hermon from Mount Mizar. So the writer of the psalm are talking about mountains in Israel. If you will notice, if you didn't know the story of the land of Israel, the geographical area, you know, the land itself, I have something here to show you. This one here, I bought this in Jerusalem. So this one tells us about the nature of the land. So here you cannot see it, you know, fully, that it shows here. If you see that in the middle, you will see that there this thing is not flat itself. It curved. You know, there. If you see it like this, so you will see that in the middle part of the land of Israel over here, they were mountains. You know, there are high places. You see, so the writer of the Psalms mentioning about the peaks of Hermon. It means because Mount Hermon is the tallest mountain in Israel, and I saw this in my own eyes when we are in the Golan Heights. You know, the peaks of Hermon, the location of this high mountain is in between Syria in the east and Lebanon in the west. All right, so this is the location of Mount Hermon. All right, so this is far away. So in this illustration here, this is the Mount Hermon up here, right? So this is the Mount Hermon. It's in the northern region of Israel, right there. You'll see it very small, right? Right there. That is the Mount Hermon over there. So this is the Syria, and this is Lebanon, right? So if you see, the Dead Sea is very low, low land, you know, and this is the lowest place on earth, okay, according to the geographical survey, and this is the Sea of Galilee. So the Jordan is in this side. This is the Jordan, the kingdom of the Hasmonean or something like that, the kingdom of Jordan, right? And this is Israel, right? And this is this is Egypt, and on the bottom is Saudi Arabia. So most of the land in Israel, especially here, Jerusalem also is mountainous too. It's in that it's a mountain, you know. It's a hill, you know. The location of the temple in Jerusalem is in the hill. You know, I saw that in my own eyes. Especially if you are in the Garden of Gethsemane, you are facing up. You will see the Eastern Gate or the Golden Gate, okay, near the location of the Second Temple. So it's in high, you know, it's in the hill. So it's sometimes that's why they say that we have to go up, you know, to Jerusalem. That's what they say all the time. So most of the places in Israel, they are all mountains, you know, high land. So that's why it's not easy to go to Jerusalem, because you have to climb hills, you know. So people are desperate, because in that time they wrote psalms in captivity. They long for to come back to their own land, you know, to live in their own land. But the problem is, like, they are in captivity. They are under different rule of foreign government. So that's why they wrote their desperation, you know, or depression outside their own land, you know. So that's why when people affected by depression, loneliness, because they are not living in their own land, they were affected by their emotions, you know. They are longing to go home, to come home. So depression affects many people in this world, especially during the time of pandemic. People became sad, and it leads to depression, loneliness, you know, because they are always in their home. Especially here in Toronto right now, the government of Ontario extended another a month again of lockdown, of stay at home policy. So some countries around the world, it's you know, going back to normal, you know, little by little. But here in Ontario, it's not like that, you know. It's continuing because of the rapid spread of the new variant that we have here. So people are talking, you know. I'm listening in the news yesterday, and people are talking, and they said that someone in the healthcare profession are running the province of Ontario. That's what they say. Not Doug Ford, because Doug Ford is listening to them. You know, the people who are looking after about this kind of pandemic issue. So people wants to go back to normal. So, but our healthcare professionals, you know, officials said that it's too early, you know, to think about this. We have to protect the citizens of this province, not because the numbers are also increasing again because of this. So depression is there, you know, people affected by this kind of situation, requiring some to seek extensive counseling sometimes and medical help. God has given us counselors in this world, doctors, and medicine to aid in healing. And meditating on the record of God's goodness to His people can also help us. There are so many ways to help us in our physical situation, our mental health, you know? Recalling how God has worked in our lives might help take our minds off the present situation and can give us hope that it will improve. So it will focus our thoughts on God's ability to help us rather than on our inability to help ourselves. So when we feel down or discouraged, let's take advantage of this Psalm's advice. Read the Bible's account of God's goodness and meditate on them. In verse 7, deep calls to deep at the sound of your waterfalls. This is the most important location sometimes during the summertime or when the good weather starts. People wants to go to waterfalls. People wants to experience the quietness of the environment in front of the waterfalls. Excuse me. And you only hear the sound of the water came from the top going down. And the people who hear those sounds will give them good feeling, you know, and soothing feeling, and they will become relaxed. You know? That's why people keep coming back to those places to experience that in their lives. It says in here also in verse 7, all your breakers and your waves have passed over me. The Lord will send His goodness in the daytime, and His song will be with me in the night, a prayer to the God of my life. So the writer of this psalm is telling us about his experience, their experience from the exile, the place that you cannot do whatever you want because you are under foreign rule. That's why the writer of this psalm expresses themselves through writings, and then it becomes a book in the Old Testament. Psalm is one of the very important book in the Old Testament. It's their book of guidance in their faith to God, a book of devotions, and a prayer, you know, and then because the Old Testament only consists three major books consists of the Old Testament, which is the book of the prophets, the book of Psalms, and the book of law. So those are the three that's very important to the Old Testament. That's why they said, the Jewish people said that there is no other scriptures beside all of these three major books, nothing else. They believe only in these books only. So until today, a lot of Jewish people still believe on this, in these theologies, that there is no other testament, no other books, except all of these three, you know, the prophets, the law, and the Psalms. That's why even our Lord Jesus Christ, when He was here on earth, He quotes a lot of scriptures from the book of Psalms, you know. And that's why this is a good book to reflect, you know, in our own lives when we are alone, praying, talking to God, and studying, you know, about in this book. So in verse 9, I will say to God, my rock, why have you forgotten me? You know, why do I go about mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? Okay, so they are telling us about their experience. They're under Persian rule, you know. So in verse 10, as a shattering of my bones, my adversaries taunt me while they say to me all day long, where is your God? You know? So because they're still in captivity, in exile. So people think that God is, you know, is leaving them. God has forgotten them. But it's not. There is a right time, you know, according to the accounts in the Old Testament, if I'm not mistaken, is after 70 years of captivity, they will coming back. They are going back to Israel, in their own home, in their own land, because they just only wait for a while until the completion of the time exists, and then they will coming back to their own land. Verse 11, why are you in despair? My soul, the spirit is talking to the soul. And why are you restless within me? Wait for God, for I will again praise him for the help of his presence, my God. And this is a prayer for help. In verse 43, vindicate me, God, and plead my case against an ungodly nation. Save me from the deceitful and unjust person, for you are the God of my strength. Why have you rejected me? Why do I go about mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? Send out your light and your truth. They shall lead me, and they shall bring me to your holy hill and to your dwelling places. So the psalmist mentioned about the holy hill. The holy hill is Mount of Zion, which is Jerusalem, okay, at your dwelling places. The holy mountain here is Mount Zion in Jerusalem, the city that David named as Israel's capital. The temple was built there as the place for the people to meet God in worship and prayer. When I was standing in the Mount of Olives in 2 years ago, okay, in 2018, right? I saw the land, the huge land, without any temple except the Dome of the Rock. The Golden Dome, or the Muslim buildings, you know, the Dome of the Rock of the Muslim, situated in that location, you know. Then after that, you'll see on the left side, if you are standing in front of Mount Olives facing the Holy City, then you will see that there is an empty land, you know, big, huge, wide. And then on the right side is the Dome of the Rock, you know, the mosque, you know, a big one. And if the weather is clear, and then the sun, you'll see the reflection of the sun from that mosque, you know, the Dome of the Rock, they call it. And then according to the belief of the Muslims, that inside that structure building, that is the actual place of the sacrificial place where Abraham dedicated Isaac as a burnt offering, you know, to God in Mount Moriah. That is the location of Mount Moriah, inside the Dome of the Rock, you know, the Golden Dome of the Muslim faith. That's inside there, inside of that building. That's why they said that is the actual location of the Second Temple, you know, in Jerusalem. But right now, there is no temple there. Totally empty, you know, nothing. So in verse 4, then I will go to the altar of God, to the God of my exceeding joy, and I will praise you on the lyre, God, my God. So here, the descendants of Korah worship the God of Israel through musical instrument. So people in Old Testament, they worship God with their different kinds of instrument, especially David. David also loves music because he is a musician. And he played an instrument, you know, in front of King Saul when he became the part of the household of King Saul in that time. So if you're a musician, you will appreciate all different kinds of instrument. And you love music, and then music also is worshiping as one of the form of worshiping God. So the psalm writer asked God to send his light and truth to guide him to the holy mountain, which is in Jerusalem, the location of the temple, where he would meet God. And God's truth provides the right path to follow, according to 1 John chapter 2, verse 27. So the God's light provides the clear vision to follow it. 1 John chapter 1, verse 5. Okay? If we feel surrounded by darkness and uncertainties, follow God's light and truth, and God will guide us, will guide you. So verse 5, why are you in despair, my soul? And why are you restless within me? Wait for God, for I will again praise him for the help of his presence, my God. So this is the life application to all of us, according to all of these verses that we read. In some countries, when you purchase a computer or other technical device or devices, you get a warranty with it. You will receive a warranty, you know, when you purchase one. Together with the computer or telephone, you have access to all the technical support that you need and more. So the aim is that you do not have to worry at all when you purchase that merchandise. So they even go so far as to offer to replace the whole device, if needed, a true warranty of value. So it's very different in our personal lives. No worry-free guarantee comes with our lives. Even if good marketing companies want us to think so, life is fragile and vulnerable. It is not quickly repaired or reinstalled and never replaced. On the contrary, life is irreplaceable and cannot be repeated. It is precious, and so we worry. That's why when Jesus was this on earth 2,000 years ago, he always say to us through the scriptures, through the gospels, that don't worry, he said. No? God knows what you need. That's what Jesus said. No? Jesus knows. So this is also advice to each one of us also, that we don't need to worry during the pandemic time. God is still in control, you know. So in the diverse regions around our globe on this earth, we face all kinds of threats and oppressions, as well as harassment, racism, and different kinds of fears. And in this last week and months, through the COVID-19 pandemic, even more uncertainty and great unease have been added to the existing anxieties we face. This new variant that is spreading again, you know, some of them from South Africa, some of them from Brazil, some from UK, because the first variant that after COVID-19 is coming from UK. And after that, then South Africa, and after that in Brazil. So now, here in Canada, most of the people are scared because of the variant coming from Brazil. So now people you know, think about these things as serious, you know, situation. So that's why they say, you know, don't take it easy, because this is stronger than the COVID-19 virus. So it is not a simple challenge. It because aggravating the anxieties we already have. The whole of humanity is now facing the pandemic with a heightened sense of uncertainty, especially those who have always been the most vulnerable. It is especially these vulnerable who cannot just adhere to the call to stay at home, because they have to feed their children by earning daily or getting the daily shopping done at the market. They do not have the luxury of a refrigerator where they can store a week's worth of groceries. Many do not know how to survive till next week. Never mind securing their financial futures. There is also so much uncertainty around the virus, and sometimes fueled by misleading biblical interpretations from some uninformed church leaders or political rulers who do not acknowledge the menace and very real threat which comes from this virus. So as with a deadly wound in our bodies, our adversaries taunt us while they say to us continually, where is your God? Why are you cast down, O my soul? And why are you disquieted within me? Hope in God, for I shall again praise him, my help and my God. And so I ask myself, is this the only way out of such a situation? By worrying? Is falling into a deep valley full of sorrows the only thing left for us? So the text in this context is telling us that the Bible is no stranger to this condition. It is filled with stories of people and their sorrows. It knows about people who are living in distress. Since the dawn of time, people and believers have been struggling with this. God, who has not given us a worry-free guarantees so as to enjoy life unimpaired. So instead, we face challenges that cause agitation, anxiety, and apprehension in us. And there is nothing carefree about that. In the Gospel of Matthew, we learn exactly the opposite. When Jesus teaches us, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Taken from Matthew chapter 6, verse 34. So, but can we do this and put this advice into practice in the time of this pandemic, in a time with so many doubts and insecurities? It can also be a good question to all of us. As human beings, we worry. But we must rely on the words of our Lord Jesus Christ that do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Life must go on. You know, it will pass, this pandemic, one day. So in Psalms chapter 42 and 43, the psalmist shows us a way to live despite the massive worries we have and how to handle them. So these scriptures, the Psalms invited us to read these Psalms, pondering their message. Deal with it. So it means that let's face it. You know, accept the words from this holy book. Accept the fact that we can overcome this with the help of our Lord Jesus Christ. The two Psalms are structured in stanzas, you know, as in music, like the words of the songs and refrains, you know, going back to the same words, you know. And we are not told who the lyrical narrator might be. You know, these Psalms didn't mention the names, just as in the headings of the chapter 42. And we can, however, be sure that it is someone who is in distress and oppressed during exile. Someone who feels attacked by others and full of sorrow. That's why the psalmist said that my soul thirsts for God in verse 2 of chapter 42. It is a picture of his or her longing for God. Their tears have been their food day and night. Imagine, no? They're crying most of the time because of this of their situations. Fellow humans are provoking them because they trust in God. Verse 4. The narrator feels as if he or she is drowning in verse 8. It is not surprising that their soul is downcast and disturbed in verse 5, and that they are full of sorrows. Yet the author of these Psalms trusts fully in God. He or she is asking God to send your light and your truth to us in verse 3, and hopes fully in God in verse 11. So knowing that God is their stronghold and delight in verse 4, surprisingly, the narrator of the psalm is talking to him or himself. Whoever it is talking to their own soul. These two psalms are a conversation, excuse me, with oneself. The narrator exhorts his or her soul to put It's hope in God in verse 10, chapter 43, verse 10. Why is the narrator acting like this? Because he or she knows, he or she is convinced that God will help and save in due time. God will not abandon us in this unprecedented time. So the text in our context here saying that what can we learn from this experience? When we get into situations of distress and sorrow, situations of anxiety and uncertainty, it is important that we act as the narrator of Psalms 42 and 43 does. It is crucial that we too speak out our sorrows, that we verbalize what distresses us, that we are honest with ourselves and also with God by telling God what depresses us, and we should not give up when sorrows takes over. When we are consumed with doubts and anxiety, we need not despair when we are overwhelmed by our emotions and when some people try and convince us with comments like, God is no longer present or God has forsaken us. You know? So especially then, we should concentrate again on God's message. We believe in a God of hope. Yes, there are some things in life which cannot change, which we have to accept in humility and humbleness. All we can do is try and make the best of them. But on the other hand, God wants us to change those things and circumstances which we can, knowing that we are fully loved because of God's grace can empower us. Even if we are weak and full of sorrow, we can be assured that God is with us and lead us through our dark valleys. So the Apostle Paul was also full of sorrow and even pain, you know, and he knew that he had no power, and yet he didn't give up. On the contrary, his faith in God led him to write these beautiful words in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. The Lord said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness, so I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may dwell in me. No? Praise God for this wonderful statement by Apostle Paul. God's grace is sufficient for all of us to overcome distress and sorrow in this world. Because of God's grace, I am what I am. That's what Apostle Paul said. Recognizing this gift can help us handle worries and uncertainty. During this time of crisis, we are not only faced with an increase of sorrow, but also of hope. Humanity is developing new ways of interacting. New forms of togetherness are being institutionalized. We have become more sensitive to the needs of others. People are rediscovering the helpful side of prayers. Environmental pollution is diminishing. We are focusing more on the important things of life, realizing that health and relationships are what is most important in this life. So we can move on forward by trusting in God. As Dietrich Bonhoeffer wrote, I believe that God both wills and is able to bring good out of everything, even the worst. So this is the final words of this lesson that we are sharing together. May this lesson will help us to understand about sometimes we're experiencing sorrows in our lives, but without fear. You know, we can feel this, but we know that God is there to help us in the time of need. This is also an invitation for all of us to encounter God in our situation. He's there watching for all of us. Then I thank everyone for this studying from the book of Psalms 42 and 43, and continue reading this in your home when you have spare time, and meditate on these words of chapter 42 and 43. This is a good books to use it for your own devotions, you know, talking to God in prayer, and learn from the past, you know, experience of the descendants of this of writers of this book, and may their examples of disobedience will taught us, you know, to remain true to God, to remain faithful to God, not that what they do in the time of Moses. So, brothers and sisters, have a nice day for all of us, and then happy Lord's Day, everyone. And let's continue our worship today in the second part of our service in Kill Street Christian Church live stream account. Then we'll see each other there. And thanks everyone also watching from the Philippines and other parts of the world. And may the kindness and love from our God be with you all. And to those brothers and sisters who are following my live stream later, we'll see you this afternoon around 4 o'clock here in Toronto and 5 o'clock in the morning there in the Philippines. So thanks everyone. God bless you all. And we'll see you next Sunday for our lesson 3. And let's continue our worship this morning in the church. God bless you all and have a great day, everyone. Bye now.